500 years ago, there were people on both sides of the Atlantic Ocean, but neither knew about the other. On the western side, our side, the people had reddish-brown skins and lived in huts or wigwams. On the eastern side, in Europe, the people were white-skinned. They had learned how to build houses and large sailing ships, but they still didn't know much about the rest of the world.
Mr. Chairman, I've been a member of this committee now for 27 years. And of those years, I've served, and I've had the honor of serving as either chairman or vice chairman for 17. And throughout those years, I've sat on this panel and listened to hundreds of stories of pain and shame, of discrimination, of broken promises. I've heard stories of the high rate of diabetes, the worst in the United States, in fact, worse than some of the third world countries, of the number of amputees and the blind. I've heard horror stories of glaucoma, where the rest of the population has never heard of it, but in Indian country it's commonplace. I've heard of the suicide rates among Alaskan teenagers, 7 times that of the national norm. I've heard of drug abuse, substance abuse in Indian country, about 50% higher than the rest of the nation, and yet we have only 11 DEA agents. At the same time, we know that more Native Americans have volunteered and put on the uniform of this nation since World War I than any other ethnic group. Even today, more Indians die. The land that we reside on belonged to the Indians, but we take that for granted. These walls have heard all these stories. We have heard these stories. The record would show these stories, but who reads those records? So, let's get down to work. We got a story to tell, a good story. And it's about time the rest of America find out.
Everybody thinks of 1492 as some magic date in which Columbus discovered, quote, America. But Columbus was in the Caribbean, and he never at any time came to the United States.
No, he never was near the continental mass of America. He, the great navigator that he was, you know, who washed up on a beach in the Caribbean, half a world away from where he thought he was, gets known as the great navigator. The navigator could never find his way from the island to the mainland. He couldn't discover the continent.
Oh, I think it is rather surprising that they should have reddish-brown skins. But now since we have landed in India, then these people must be Indians.
It's very interesting that Columbus's first comments regarding the Native American or the indigenous people was that they were very loving, giving. They would trade or give anything that they had. They were without malice, without guile. The whole concept that Columbus thought these were savage people was totally incorrect.
This part of India, San Salvador, and I take possession of it in the name of the King and Queen of Spain.
It's hard to discover an occupied territory. I often go for the first time to visit people who have moved into the area. It may be the first time I've been to their living room, but I can hardly say I discovered it. I mean, after all, they lived there. Much less can I extrapolate by virtue of my noble achievement of knocking on their door that somehow or another the newly discovered living room becomes mine.
The general consensus is that Spain came for God, glory, and gold, and God being that they were going to spread the Catholic religion, glory because they were going to add more land to the crown, and of course gold because they were going to get rich.
Columbus had no trouble getting ships and men for his second voyage, but he still hadn't the slightest idea that he was headed for the vast continent of America.
They issued documents to the native people to be read to the native people, saying if you don't convert to Catholicism and give us the gold, we will do all types of harm to you. We will kill your families. We will take your land. We will enslave you. And when native people didn't tell them where the gold was, or in many cases didn't know where the gold was, the Spanish simply tortured these people. They burned them at the stake alive. They had large hunting dogs that they fed the Indians to. It was death and destruction.
Bartolome de las Casas, who was there during Columbus's tenure as governor of the island, placed the beginning population at about 3 million. 20th century historical demographic studies had placed it as high as 8.5 million. Whatever the reality actually was, it had been reduced to about 100,000 by the time he left, and by 1550, it was gone. Extinct. Columbus is symbolic, but what Columbus symbolizes is hideous. Columbus being valorized in the mythology of the United States is roughly the same as Germany valorizing Heinrich Himmler now, and in teaching this to Jewish students as well as German students, and conditioning them to accept it.
But each year on October 12th, we celebrate Columbus Day. The anniversary of that day in 1492, when Columbus first sighted the land of the New World, America.
The U.S. is in it's a strange society because I think consciously the country wants to believe that it does good and that it has, you know, good intentions around the world, and it's not very in touch with its subconscious self that's a lot meaner and a lot more homicidal than the self that it would like to acknowledge.
Do you think that genocide is too strong a word to what's happened?
Absolutely not. At times it did fit all the definitions of genocide.
The United Nations Political Committee debates an issue as vital as any in its history.
Article 2 of the Convention reads pretty much as follows. Genocide shall be understood as any policy undertaken with intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnical, racial, or religious group as such. The first is killing members of the group.
At various times in this country's history, there have been policies that would equate to genocide because they say kill them all. They make no provisions for taking of prisoners, and they use words like exterminate and decimate. In some of these warfare, they say kill them all, mitts make lice. That means kill the children because they'll grow up to be Indian.
Territory of Colorado became a state by virtue of proclaiming an extermination policy against the Cheyennes and Arapahoes and actualizing that in the Sand Creek Massacre of November 1864. Very proud moment, celebrated in the Rocky Mountain News, okay, at the time, and in all the annals of the history, and that's what resulted in the Plains region of Colorado being cleared of its Indian population.
Thank you. is time, when it is time, they'll come for you in your bed. When it is time, they'll come for you in your bed. They'll come for you, they'll come for you, they'll come for you in your bed. They'll come for you, they'll come for you, they'll come for you in your bed. Just wait your turn, live well and learn. They'll come for you in your bed. Don't feel too blue, there's lots left to do till they come for you in your bed. There is no proof that this is true. They'll come for you in your bed. But they couldn't say, even if they knew, they'll come for you in your bed. When they are through dealing with you, they'll come for me in my bed. And after they're done having their fun, someone else will get it instead.
Early on, particularly during the French and Indian Wars and the Revolutionary War, there was a bounty paid for Indian scalps by the English.
Meanwhile, on the other hand, there is this unceasing emphasis on Indians engaging in the practice.
Oh, gee, real Indians! Oh, wigwam beauty shop.
These were bounties, a different amount for men, women, and children, and they were supposed to be hostile Indians, but there was no tag on the scalp that said this came from whom.
They'll pay you, say, 40 pounds sterling for the man, 20 pounds sterling for the woman, 10 pounds sterling for the child. Well, 40 pounds sterling is about the annual wage of your average farmer, so this becomes, as I said, a commercial proposition. You have professional scalp hunters.
This goes all the way on out into California. Up in the 1860s, they're still scalping by California white people of California Indians. Okay, and they got paid for the scalps. The same thing in Colorado in the 1800s.
Well, this is about as genocidal a policy as you can come up with. For one, you're placing a price in the head of an entire race of people on the basis that you want to eradicate the race. That's patently genocidal under even the narrowest definition. The third one, which would be Article 2C, it's implementation of policy that brings about the physical destruction of the group as such. And that does not necessarily mean the destruction of the individuals in it in a personal sense, but the physical destruction of the group, a dispersal, for example, or forced off their land.
When Andrew Jackson ran for president in 1828, he was elected, but part of his platform was that he would remove all of the Indians from the Southeast.
In order to acquire Cherokee and Choctaw and Chickasaw and Creek and Seminole land, they interned the people at gunpoint, placed them in camps, and then at a certain point, they began forced march under military escort without anything resembling adequate support by way of food, medicine, shelter, or anything else. 1,500-mile forced march to Oklahoma. They always talk about a quarter of all Cherokees died on the trail. Well, the population of Cherokee was reduced by upwards of 50% as a result of that particular policy implementation.
There were many trails of tears. The Creeks, the Choctaws, Chickasaw, the Seminole, each nation lost roughly a quarter of their population.
But Andrew Jackson actually argued that it was to the interest of the Indians subjected to this for it to be done, because it would remove them from proximity to white people. What's that saying about white people? That you're better off in a forced march for 1,500 miles, reduced from your homeland under conditions that consumes half your population. You're better off with that than you are living next door to a white guy. Fourth one, it simply says prevention of births within the target group. And if you're doing that on the basis of their membership in the group, you're sterilizing an American Indian woman, for example, simply because she's an American Indian woman. It's a genocidal act.
Somebody came to me and said there's some sterilization going on of Indian women. I publicized it, I had hearings on it.
Can you remember what the findings were?
The findings were that there was indeed sterilization going on.
Based on the documents that were secured by virtue of the illegal acts of the American Indian movement, Women of All Red Nations warned that organization analyzed the documents, and they concluded on the basis of the evidence they had that it was about 42% of the overall female population of childbearing age were prevented from birth. Not only involuntarily, but in a number of cases, unwittingly. They were never even informed.
It used to be routine practice to try to sterilize Indian women after they had a very small number of children.
I mean, I don't even know how to describe how vile that was. Just absolutely incomprehensibly inhuman. And done as a matter of course. Women coming in for any reason, going out sterilized. And the final one, the fifth one, is the forced transfer of children from the targeted group to the targeting group, and that's the bit about raising them not to know who they are. Institutions for the express purpose of destroying their sense of Indian identity, to deny them the possibility of knowing their spiritual traditions.
The kids that were in the boarding schools were beaten if they spoke their tribal languages. They were forced to take English names. The names were written on blackboards, and you went out and picked up your new name is James or Mary or John.
They're constructing them to see the world through the lens of the society that despises them and theirs so much that they take a national project to destroy it. Kill the Indian, save the man, and every single pupil. That's how the architect of the U.S. system, Army Captain named Richard Henry Pratt, put it. Kill the Indian, save the man, and every child.
Some of these kids went 6, 8, 10 years without seeing their parents or their tribal people again, and so what returns is just a semblance of an Indian or a semblance of a white man. It's neither.
I'm just going to sum it up. You can ask any other questions you want, and I'll give you answers, but it may best be summed up by virtue of the fact that between 1880 in 1920, 25, that period. That's an entire generation. And running into a sect when you're dealing with kids, really, in all probability, got two generations at issue here. Okay, you've got half of all the kids as a normative figure being channeled into these schools, and half of all the kids that are going into schools are not coming out alive. That's 25% of the population that's been eradicated in these so-called educational institutions.
The graveyards speak for themselves, where little children died of heartbreak and loneliness and trying to run away. When the reservations were founded or established on Indian territory, the president handed over the reservation leadership to four different denominations and said, okay, this reservation is going to be Presbyterian, this one's going to be Catholic, this one the Indian people, this one's the government, okay, this one's going to be Catholic, this one's going to be whatever.
It wasn't like, here, you know, here's this pamphlet, read it and, you know, find the light. It wasn't like that. It was like, cut all those people's heads off and then ask these two people right here if they want to believe in this religion or not, or end up like these guys over here. And what are they going to take? You know, after seeing, you know, say 100 people killed over here, you know, what are these people going to choose? Are they going to choose that, or are they going to choose a religion?
If you were going to survive in a Catholic mission, you had to be... You were a neophyte, and then you converted. You know, those were the people that were in charge of distributing food, and cattle, and clothes, and so there was a good reason to want to convert, or at least to appear to convert.
After a while, I just couldn't handle that church, going to church three times a day, and praying every day, praying at the table, praying before you get up, praying when you get up. God, it was. I told that to that nun that one time she came to visit me. She just sat there and listened to me. She said, you know, Madeline, she said, you're not the only one that felt that way. She said, there's a lot of Indian people felt that way.
You were subjugated on the basis of systemic violence on as massive a scale as necessary to accomplish the result. And then they tune you up, the indoctrination and all the rest of that. And you get that through the schools, you get that through the prison system, you get it just through the day-to-day grind of being told no in every aspect of your existence.
We were born in sin. We were always sinning, you know. I didn't know what sin was. I said, I thought that was cruel, you know. I thought they were punishing us by making us go to church and kneeling down. I thought that was punishment.
People get tired of spending their entire life actively struggling in conjunction with all of these burdens that are imposed upon them. It's weariness, it's fatigue, it's colonialism.
I used to go to powwows, you know, I used to dance when I was, you know, younger. And after a while, as I got older, I looked around and I seen like the American flag, and I seen all these veterans and all this kind of crap. And they were all like into America. And I was like, you know, I never understood that. I was about 8, 9 years old, and I was like, wow, you know, this flag that was flowing while all these Indians were getting killed. Oh, these crosses were up in the air, you know, all while these Indians were getting killed. And, you know, you stand here looking at all these Indians, and they got that same flag, and they're worshiping that same cross.
Result, you see, there's a predictable result. And you'll find its counterpart in every colonial context you ever examine. And it's always supposed to be for the colonized's own good. It's for the good of the colonists. It's the white man's burden, as Kipling put it, yeah, to do this to people. Here, let me rape you for your own good. You'll really enjoy it. You know you want it. It's the same thing. The colonial mentality is a rapist mentality. And all of those polemics that are used to redeem a rapist, it's always the fault of the victim, She flirted, she wore the wrong clothes, she teased, she did this, she did that. The rapist's argument, apologetic, defensive posture, which is hackneyed in the extreme, which is transparent, we see through it, it's exactly correlated to the arguments of colonists. Niger's to justify colonialism.
Let me tell you just a little something about the American Indian in our land. We have provided millions of acres of land for what are called the preservations, or the reservations, I should say. They, from the beginning, announced that they wanted to maintain their way of life as they had always lived there in the desert and the plains and so forth. And we set up these reservations so they could, and have a Bureau of Indian Affairs to help take care of them. At the same time, we provide education for them, schools on the reservations. And they are free also to leave the reservations and be American citizens among the rest of us, and many do. Some still prefer, however, that early way of life. And we've done everything we can to meet their demands as to what they, how they want to live. Maybe we made a mistake. Maybe we should not have humored them in that wanting to stay in that kind of primitive lifestyle. Maybe we should have said, no, come join us, be citizens, along with the rest of us. As I say, many have been very successful. And I'm very pleased to meet with them, talk with them at any time, and see what their grievances are or what they feel they might be. And you'd be surprised. Some of them became very wealthy because some of those reservations were overlaying great pools of oil. And you can get very rich pumping oil. And so I don't know what their complaint might be.
We see it from Appalachia to the Mississippi Delta, to the inner cities of our country, to the Native American communities. If we can't do this now, we will never get around to doing it. So let us give ourselves a gift for the 21st century, an America where no one is left behind and everyone has a chance.
William Julius Wilson, the sociologist who used to be at University of Chicago, did a study and was able to show that there was a cordon of employment discrimination around inner city neighborhoods. Somewhere between half and three-fourths of employers would not hire blacks under any circumstances. Now, you have the same kind of situation near reservations.
I walked clear down to this end, picked up applications, and if I could fill them out right there and talk to somebody right there, I did it. And then when I came back clear on this side of town. Well, nobody ever called. You could just tell they don't want to hire you. They look at you and they think, oh yeah, right, you know. Unless they're really in a dire need right now, they'll hire you. But if they got choices of who they're going to hire, you can easily drive through town and see who's all hired.
They hit this wall of discrimination. They go around, they try all the fast food places, they try to get construction jobs, and they keep coming up empty-handed. And they start to think after a while, well, maybe it's me. Maybe there's something wrong with me. They end up going back to the reservation. Of course, there's no employment there, very little, except for with the government or the tribal government or the schools. And a lot of times get depressed, start drinking.
I was a roofer. I was a roofer, and look at where I'm at now. I went to treatment two times. Down in Red Cloth, school down there? That bell tower? I was roofing big time. We all have to pray. You know why? That big tidal wave took up all kinds of thousands now. I hope it comes over here. Bring some more beer.
Mr. Secretary, I want to conclude by telling you that I'm very thrilled that you went to Indian country. But I think that we have to get commitments earlier out of administrations to go after these Indian health problems. But I also tell you, the problems surrounding alcohol, gangs, health are truly beyond what we understand.
That's true.
They're going to have to get so bad before we decide to do something that it's almost shameful.
Oh, there's all kinds of things that happen here. You know, there's killings, rapes, sexual abuses, assaults, you know, car accidents, child abuse, neglect, you know, spouse abuse. All these things fall into that category of alcoholism, and it's killing our nation, you know, from within.
The alcohol is so strong, it has a grip on some people where it's, they feel like there's no hope.
All growing up, my father and his brothers and neighbors and everywhere I looked, well, even the people, you know, that ran the businesses and the tribal employees, you know, even though they went to work every day, you know, you'd see them drunk too, partying. And basically, you know, growing up seeing that, that's, you know, what you think life is about.
This jail right here is a 22-bed facility. Last year we booked in, actually 2003, booked in 11,768. I mean, that is a big number for this size of a facility. So, public intoxication is our biggest problem.
At any one time, how many people are in this place?
Wow. We've had them literally just side by side. We had 20 people in here. It's, you know, with that amount of people and they're all intoxicated, anything will happen.
Let's examine Indian gene codes and see if there's some congenital predisposition to alcoholism, this kind of behavior. Let's look at what defects of Indian cultures might be that leads to these self-destructive behavior patterns. And actually, it's the matrix of colonial domination, deculturation, and the sheer brutality visited upon people from a very young age that leads to these results.
It's a cycle of depression that started probably about 500 years ago, but it especially hit when kids were taken from their families. I think losing wars, losing, being disenfranchised, not being understood by this group of people who came over and occupy this land, at one point you just have to lay your head down on the table and say, I give.
Yeah, we had, cases where people just literally drank themselves to death. Young people, which was surprising to me. We had a young guy, 25, I think he was, died of cirrhosis. Another girl, mid-20s, just drank themselves to death. And no one wants to really deal with it. You know, they expect the jails and the courts to deal with it, but these are our people. We should reach out to our people. You know, we need commitment.
We held a meeting in the Oval Office one day some years ago with certain tribal chairs, and they came in, and one of them stood up and said, I come from a third world country. And he read for the president the data, the statistics about his reservation. And they are likely similar to the statistics nationally.
Studies show that American Indians and Alaska Natives die at a higher rate than other Americans from alcoholism, tuberculosis, auto accidents, diabetes, homicide, and suicide. In addition, a safe and adequate water supply and waste disposal facility, something we all take for granted, isn't available in 12% of American Indian and Alaska Native homes, as opposed to 1% in the rest of the nation.
Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member, I brought to Congress
bottles of water from Indian reservations. Here's one. This is what people are expected to drink. And they cut the funding to get decent quality water to these people. I mean, that is inexplicable. It is outrageous. I must say, I don't know what these people are thinking of.
This is a very, very depressing place. You know, you get off the reservation, you go off the reservation, and you're like, man, this is so cool, you know. You got all these things going on, all these places to go, things to do. You come back to the reservation, as soon as you hit that border on each end of the reservation, it's like, oh man, I'm back, you know. And your pressure is right there again, you know. Because as soon as you get here, you see, you know, a drunk walking here, or you see an ambulance going by, a helicopter coming, cop car flying by, you know. It's like, oh man. Here we go again, it's same old, same old.
Do you see a connection between substance abuse or alcohol abuse and suicide?
Absolutely, Mr. Chairman.
Is it usually associated with suicide?
There is often the presence of either a substance abuse disorder or the presence of the use of substances, either alcohol or drugs, prior to the completion of a suicide.
Is there a large percentage that are from single parent homes?
If depression exists, then depression comes from a variety of not only internal factors, but also external factors. And the fact that there may be disrupted family life, there may be a low socioeconomic condition, all of those contribute to the factors that would lead individuals who have experience of depression to then move further and consider taking their own lives. There were many policies passed, but that did not work. The essence of those policies was the dismantling of our families and the breakup of the structure of how our families lived and the way we lived. To me, the suicide epidemic happening in Indian country is just a manifestation of all this history.
Like, if my friends is Muslim or godparents, it's like step uncles or something, like uncles, mostly aunties.
Are there any kids with both parents or one parent?
No. I don't know. Do you know any of our parents that have just like two parents? I know Josh has a mom, but he never sees it.
Mr. Secretary, there's a young girl who recently took her own life on the Spirit Lake Nation. Her name was Avis Littlewind, and Avis Littlewind was a seventh grader, and she liked riding horses, and she liked playing basketball and listening to music. And they found her hanging in her closet one morning. She was laying in a fetal position in her bed for 90 days, missing school. Her sister had taken her own life. 2 weeks after they found her, her other sister drowned driving under the influence of alcohol. Her father had died of a self-inflicted bullet wound. I went to that reservation just some weeks ago to meet with school administrators, met with some of the classmates of this young girl. What I found there is pretty much what I found in other areas as well. It's a profound lack of resources.
See a lot of kids running around with rope burns from trying to hang themselves. They're the same age as my baby, you know. It's hard with all that stuff just stuffed in you and kept there and pushed in you and pushed in you and hate and anger constantly all your life. Raised that way and to turn around and just see these beautiful little children, you don't want to touch any of it, you know. It's like poison. It kills me, you know, when you have that little baby, you don't expect it to grow up and be, you know, you just want the best for your kids and everything. And seeing their parents, it's really hard not to punch them out and say, look at your baby, straighten up and do something for them, you know.
I hear a lot of stories of people going to the bars, they leave the kids in their cars, and they're just in there to do what they will for till mom or dad's back out and ready to roll home, and no one's had a conversation with them. Practically no one's changed their diapers.
We go to houses where we've seen babies just covered in flies during the summertime, you know, because they're just so dirty, you know, their pampers are just filthy and the parents are drunk, you know. And man, we went to this house one time and the baby was, must have been 7-8 months old, and just covered with flies, you know.
Me and Paul and probably my friend James are probably the only people that really talk to our parents. I don't know, everybody else is like, mom, they're by themselves or whatever. And that's how they think or something.
My understanding is that we have trust responsibility for two groups of people for health care in this country. One are prisoners in the federal prison system, and the other a trust responsibility for Native Americans. My understanding further is that we spend exactly twice as much per person on health care for federal prisoners as we do to make available health care for American Indians.
Indian Health Service is now funded, you know, overall at about 50% of need. 50%. You go to an Indian Health Service hospital and it looks like a hospital in the Soviet Union. People are laying in the hallways and lined up and it takes forever to be seen.
I mentioned Avis Littlewind, who hung herself, a poor child that really lost hope and had serious emotional problems, but there wasn't enough mental health capability available. There weren't the skilled people available to be able to provide services to her. And so a young girl dies.
I was suicidal when I was younger, desperate, frantic to get help. And I go to this man, and I seen a picture of him on the wall. I said, an employee of the month. He's a mental health person. And I went to him. He says, well, there's a seminar. And I was like, well, he's going to help me. Maybe he wants me to sit in on a seminar, and maybe I can really learn something from it. You know, after I agreed to go, he's like, well, I'm going to get a room for the two of us. Don't tell anyone about it. And, you know, and we won't let nobody know. And I'll just go to the seminar and come back and, you know, I'll see you. And I'm like, what? I don't know what in the world that I've told that man to make him think that I wanted to him but other than spill my heart out and ask him for help. And I don't know how he felt like that was going to help me, but that's what he offered.
You know, you've got people who need all kinds of care that aren't getting it, and you know, it's a tragedy in the making. If we see the economy take any kind of a downturn, a serious downturn, you're going to see those people who are so fragile and so on the edge go over the edge.
At approximately 3 p.m. today, there was a shooting at the Red Lake High School. We have 6 confirmed dead at this time, 1 teacher, 1 security officer, and 4 students.
You could hear a girl saying, no, quit, no, Jeff, quit, quit, leave me alone, why are you doing this? And then boom, 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 and then no more screaming.
As we're talking here, we have just confirmed that there are currently 8 dead right now.
There are 10 dead, 12 wounded, and I can tell you that some of them are hanging on by a thread tonight.
The incident began on Monday when police say 17-year-old Jeff Wees went to the home of his grandfather, a longtime Red Lake police officer. Wees shot and killed his grandfather and his grandfather's partner. He then grabbed his grandfather's police 40 caliber handgun and 12-gauge shotgun and headed off toward the high school in a squad car. Police say Wees shot and killed the security guard, then roamed through the school shooting dead 5 students and a teacher, before retreating to a classroom and shooting himself in the head. In 97, Wees's father committed suicide following a police standoff that lasted for more than a day. Years later, his mother suffered brain damage in a car accident after she and a friend had been drinking.
Having a parent who had ended his life some years ago for this young man, that is not uncommon in Indian country. We have many, many young people who don't have, they have a loss of one parent or two.
comparing this to the tragedy of Columbine several years ago, when the entire nation seemed to grieve, and the press coverage was almost nonstop of the incident. Do you think that there is a marked difference in the reaction because this occurred on Native land?
It's a class issue. Columbine was an upper middle class community. This is not. This country has failed our people, and now all of a sudden we're focused like Columbine. This is not. This is totally different.
I think it is very interesting and remarkable that President Bush has failed to make any comment on what has happened. I think it's hard for a leader of the United States to really acknowledge indigenous pain, because that brings up the whole cultural and historical legacy.
President, you've been a governor and a president, so you have a unique experience looking at it from two directions. What do you think tribal sovereignty means in the 21st century, and how do we resolve conflicts between tribes and the federal and state governments?
Yeah. Tribal sovereignty means that. It's sovereign. You've been given sovereignty, and you're viewed as a sovereign entity.
Okay.
And therefore, the relationship between the federal government and tribes is one between sovereign entities.
As you saw today at the president's conference, the leader of the free world does not understand tribal sovereignty. What would you do, in your estimation, Reverend, what would you do, and how would you advise tribes to educate our folks just exactly what tribal sovereignty is?
The president explained. You just didn't understand. Sovereignty is sovereign. You understand? It's like in sovereignty. If you're on the reservation, you've been sovereignized. Your PhD is in sovereign vacation. You understand? I mean, I don't think you understand. What?
You're right. I didn't understand that.
Well, needless to say, that the sovereignty of American Native American tribes are federally protected rights. And as long as Native Americans were perishing on those reservations, it didn't matter to states. But now that you have gaming on the reservations and economic development on the reservations, indeed in some states voting on the reservations, the state now wants to impose itself on the federally protected sovereignty of tribes.
The states have learned how to interfere with the development of Indian gaming. It's a blackmail scheme. You know, we'll interfere and throw up roadblocks until you throw us some money or pay us off somehow or give us a bone, and then we'll go away. You know, it's a protection scheme or protection racket. The mob could learn from that.
Well, it's very interesting because when Schwarzenegger was running for governor, okay, when he was trying to get, they were trying to get Gray Davis out of office and Schwarzenegger into office, Schwarzenegger said, if I'm elected, I will make the Indian people pay $8 billion. The governor cannot make Indian people do anything. Indian people are sovereign nations.
Indian activists have accused the governor of an insensitive slur after he was quoted recently as saying, "The Indians are ripping us off." He was talking about the Indian gaming initiatives on the November ballot. Today he made it clear he's not apologizing for what he said.
Read my lips. The Indian gaming tribes with Proposition 70 are trying to rip off California. I will say it again and again and again.
Allow me to negotiate the fair share, the billions from Indian gaming our state deserves.
Who said that? Schwarzenegger? Yeah. Yeah, that takes a lot of amnesia to be able to say that.
The two worst states in this nation for treatment of Indian people are California and Texas. And this state ripped Indian people off of all their land. There were 18 treaties negotiated with Indian people. The Indian people gave up their land. Congress never ratified the treaties. And the Indian people, we've got Indian people in California without land. They're full-bloods, and they're not even recognized as Indian people. They don't get any gaming money. They're not ripping anybody off. They lost, okay? And you can go all the way back to Spain, to the Spanish in California. Now, Schwarzenegger needs another course in U.S. history. And I volunteered once to give it to him.
Unfortunately, Indian gaming has gotten to be a joke because people have seen these few large successful casinos near urban areas and think that that's the norm when in fact they're the exception.
The average person out in the public thinks Native Americans are walking around with money stuffed out of their pockets, and it simply isn't true. 90% of Native Americans are not touched by this at all. Another 5-6% barely derive any benefit at all from it. It goes to a handful of people.
Most gaming occurring on Indian reservations around the country is very small in scale. They don't have the population centers to support it. They don't make that big of a contribution to the tribe's general fund or its coffers.
Many of these tribes with the most profitable casinos have only a few dozen or a few hundred members. At the same time, you have, you know, a quarter million Navajo, 20% of whom still don't have indoor plumbing. And yet this was a piece of legislation that was supposed to make Indian tribes self-sufficient. It was economic development. It was to strengthen tribal governments. It has done none of those things for a majority of Indian tribes in this country.
There's 290 Indian casinos. We estimate about four of them comprise probably 25% of the revenue. So that gives you an idea how few are really benefiting.
I worry that if people think that gaming is so successful that they'll start ending their support for the subsidies that keep Indian tribes going. And I worry about the poor Indian tribes, which is the vast majority, and what will happen to them if gaming continues to be so successful in just those few urban centers like Minnesota and Connecticut and California.
Why is it that the states, many states, refuse to provide assistance for your educating non-Indian students in tribal colleges? About 20% of the student body are non-Indians, isn't that correct?
20% are non-Indians, yes.
Can you tell me why the states are reluctant to provide assistance? They do it for other colleges.
I can answer that in terms of North and South Dakota. That's where Sitting Bull College and Standing Rock Reservation is located. In North Dakota, we have approached the state legislative body a number of times, and the last time that we approached them, their response to us was that since the North Dakota tribes have casinos and many non-Indians go to those casinos, that's how they are making their contribution to Indian education is by going to our casinos and spending their money. That was, in fact, one of the comments we heard back from one of the senators of South Dakota.
They seriously told you that?
North Dakota. South Dakota did appropriate $50,000 for the tribal colleges for the non-Indian students attending there. However, the governor at that time said that he thought it was unconstitutional to give money to a special group within the state and therefore refused to release the $50,000. Our comment back was every group that comes to the state legislative body, whether it be farmers, ranchers, handicapped personnel, veterans, anybody is a special group that goes there, and so he should have released the money.
Well, we got problems.
The kind of distance that the bigger society, that the white society has placed, and they've made us into this myth, and to skip over the incredible kind of life we had to leave to even make it this far, even to survive this far, it's dangerous, and it's dangerous to the fact that you can now go to another country like Iraq and go and decimate it and probably end up with the same sort of distance that they put on what it took to kill a society.
You would have heard in 1996, I think it was, when Madeleine Albright was interviewed by Leslie Stahl in 60 Minutes, and she was told, "It's our understanding from UN data that upwards of 500,000 Iraqi children have died of preventable causes as a result of the imposition of U.S. sanctions on Iraq. What do you think about that?"
I mean, that's more children than died in Hiroshima. And you know, is the price worth it?
I think this is a very hard choice, but we think the price is worth it.
We've decided it's worth the cost. We. Who in the hell is we? She and policymakers in the United States had decided it was worth the cost in somebody else's children. A 500,000 children in a population of barely 18 million at the time. An entire coming generation decimated, survivors deformed by the experience and the deprivation. She had decided, in concert with other U.S. policymakers, that that cost was acceptable for the U.S. to accomplish policy objectives.
To really understand that kind of pain, I don't think that is I think something that devastates us all. It's been an incredibly painful experience that white people don't seem to understand. They don't seem to have that depth of understanding that you don't just go in and do that to a society and expect, and then step back and act like we had to do it.